Brexit. When will it end? Imagine the day when the Prime Minister steps out from the doors of number 10 Downing Street and announces that Brexit is finally over. Whether we remain or leave, the sense of relief will be incomparable. But without repeating the TDLR video, I want to explain when Brexit will end and, more importantly, what is most likely to happen between now and then. Even if you don't agree with me, consider subscribing by the end of the video. So just to be clear, the UK voted to leave the EU on the 23rd of June 2016. However, it took until the 29th of March 2017 to start the process that enabled us to leave with a deal. This process is called Article 50. This started a two-year time period where we were originally going to leave on the 29th of March 2019. However, by the end of that period, the UK still hadn't agreed to a deal, with Parliament voting against the withdrawal agreement three times. That left three options: revoke Article 50 and end Brexit altogether, remaining within the European Union, which Parliament rejected; leave without a deal, essentially throwing away the past 2 years of negotiations with the EU and trading with the European Union on World Trade Organization terms, which Parliament also rejected; or extending the Article 50 process to leave with a deal, which Parliament accepted. So Theresa May was forced to go to the EU and ask for an extension. Now, she asked to extend until the 30th of June, when new MEPs had to take their seats. That was so the UK didn't have to take part in EU elections. If the UK had to take part in European elections, it would embarrass the Prime Minister and indeed the two main political parties who have been promising the UK will leave the EU. The UK would also incur the costs of running those elections. So instead, the aim was to leave enough time so that Parliament could agree a way of leaving, but still not take part in European elections, which May thought would be when MEPs take their seats in July, hence leaving just before that on the 30th of June. Instead, the EU replied and said that it's actually when we have European elections on the 23rd of May. Therefore, we have to leave just before that on the 22nd of May so that the UK doesn't have to take part in such EU elections. Don't forget, it's in the EU's interest to not have a member state with a number of Brexit-supporting MEPs vetoing EU budgets. So it's entirely within their interest to not allow the UK to take part in EU elections too. So originally, the 22nd of May, the day before EU elections, was the original extension cut-off date. But the EU was also aware that time was needed for the UK to transfer all the new laws the UK agreed within the withdrawal agreement into UK law. So the 12th of April was the original first step date of accepting the withdrawal agreement itself, allowing the time between the 12th of April and the 22nd of May to ratify the deal and transfer all of those laws. But then it got close to the 12th of April and still Parliament had not agreed the deal. So once again, Parliament held a vote on leaving without a deal, and they voted against that. And they didn't even bother trying to revoke Article 50 because it didn't have the support of the House. Instead, they held a series of indicative votes indicating what they might support, and it became clear that while there was no majority for anything in particular, a second referendum or a deal that meant remaining in a customs union would be more popular than the rest. This was a similar offer to what Labour had been offering all along since the 2017 election. So after a lengthy cabinet discussion in which the idea of leaving without a deal was discussed, the cabinet agreed that a deal agreed between Labour and the Conservatives was the best route forward to getting a deal agreed by Parliament. Why? Because Parliament had rejected leaving without a deal and were threatening to revoke Article 50 and remain in the EU altogether should the government pursue such a no-deal path, which for both economic certainty and trust in politics was a lose-lose situation. No deal creates economic uncertainty, while revoking Article 50 dissolves political trust, and both were likely to happen if that course of action was to be pursued by the government. Whereas, offering to soften the deal by remaining in a customs union or adding a second referendum with maybe an option to remain to that deal might well gain some votes in Parliament, but still wouldn't ascertain a majority of the leaders of the second biggest party, the Labour Party, if the Labour Party still had reservations about a Tory-branded Brexit. So by giving the Labour Party the brush to brand the deal with, it can win the backing of both the Labour Party and at least half of the Conservatives who are happy with a softer form of Brexit. It also became clear that the governing coalition, which included Conservatives who wanted a hard Brexit, Conservatives who wanted a soft Brexit, and the DUP who didn't like the Irish backstop, were never going to agree fully with the withdrawal agreement as it stood. So reach out to opposition support, ignoring Conservatives and the DUP, who didn't like the deal, was the way forward. However, people who hate each other working together and then saying, you know those people that we said would destroy the country? Well, we helped them do their thing, would likely divide the parties and either lead to a no agreed deal or lead to a massive compromise which splits the parties in two. Some of Labour want a second referendum with an option to remain. Others want to leave with a customs deal. Some Conservatives want to leave both the customs union and single market. Others would be happy remaining in one or both. Either way, it was going to take time more than the 12th of April would allow. So May had to go back to the EU and ask again for her original deadline of the 30th of June. The UK needs Brexit to be over quickly before the EU elections, but still needs time to agree a deal. The EU doesn't want to be adding month-long extensions over and over again, so instead agreed until the 31st of October. This would mean the UK would have to take part in European elections, but it is a flexible extension with a review in June. So in other words, the sooner we can agree a deal, the sooner we can leave the EU, or at least begin phase two of the negotiations where we enter into a transition period and negotiate the future trade relationship for 2 years. However, if Labour and the Conservatives don't agree a deal, then another series of legally binding indicative votes will occur. The other likely thing to happen is that the next few weeks will determine the future trade relationship with the EU, which is yet to be negotiated during the transition period and is yet to become legally binding. In other words, whatever the outcome of the negotiations between Labour and the Conservatives or the indicative votes, it cannot change the withdrawal agreement itself, which the DUP and the ERG dislike in particular because of the Irish backstop. The Irish backstop forcibly leads us into a customs territory against our will if an alternative to the Irish border cannot be found, while a chosen customs union is at least democratically accepted by a majority of Parliament, although there isn't much difference apart from that. What's even more likely to happen between now and then are days and weeks when the top news items are not related to Brexit. We saw that in early 2018, and it was implied by the government that talks were going on behind the scenes. But the reality is, the news is silent because there's a sticking point which the government are struggling to find a positive spin for. The Common Rule Book was one of those points, the Irish backstop was another. When silence happens, we can expect disappointment at the end. It's unlikely the government, Parliament, and even Labour would agree with holding a second referendum in the time given, because they're so divided. As for the £4 million in no-deal preparations, well, so far, they seem to have been wasted as well. So we can expect some form of Brexit agreement coming out within that time, but negotiations still have a long way to go yet. The Easter parliamentary recess between the 11th and the 23rd of April, the local elections on the 2nd of May, European elections on the 22nd of May, summer recess between the end of July and the beginning of September, the conference season between September and October, and even the autumn budget will all carry on as normal. leaving not much time for actual Brexit stuff. But do you agree with me? Join in the debate below and subscribe.